Good afternoon, YouTube. So here's the front shock setup I have on my 1985 Toyota 4Runner. I built this probably 23 years ago. This is my, what I call version 2. I modified the original setup a little bit. In the stock form, you used to have a shock tower back here on the frame that came up to someplace around here, and that's where you mounted your front shock to and connected down to the axle. The problem with the factory shock tower is it really limited how much shock absorber length you could have, because you had a minimum compressed length that restricted how long of a shock body you could fit in there, and then that in turn limited how much droop the front suspension had. Anyway, I came up with this setup here based on an idea by a fellow in Australia. His name was James Stevenson, and he ran a website called Tonka Tough. And I guess he used to race four-wheel drive trucks in some sort of competition class. They had a rule that you could modify the suspension, but you couldn't do any modification to the body. You couldn't cut the fenders, you couldn't cut a hole in the top of the fender to put a longer shock tower up there. You had to keep everything under the body like it was factory. So James came up with this, basically a folded shock setup. Here's the shock that's connected down to the axle. These two side shocks are mounted to the frame here with these auxiliary brackets. And I have this bracket here bolted into the frame. These two shocks attach to the frame. This shock down there attaches to the axle. But up on top here, they just float. There's no connection up here on the top. Two shocks on the side just serve to be a place to mount this center shock. And right now, these two side shocks are fully extended. So these are Rancho shocks. I had a buddy that worked for Rock Shocks, and he had a bunch of stickers, so I put those on there. But these are old Rancho 9120s. They're the adjustable shock. So I have the adjuster in the back there so it doesn't get damaged. 9120, you could also use the 5120, which is the non-adjustable. But these shocks have about 4.5 inches of travel here. And that 4.5 inches adds on to the 14 inches of travel of this center shock, giving you about 18.5 inches of total shock travel. And that's probably an inch or two more than my front suspension travel is. So the idea with this is the shocks never limit the travel. There's always this much up travel, and then on the down travel, these side shocks will compress and the center shock will pull down. So I'll cut in a couple of photos showing you full compression and full extension on this setup. But it works very well. But let me show you on the other side of the truck. I've got a bit of a problem that I need to fix. Okay, here we are on the driver's side of the truck. And you notice I've got this top rod here disconnected, because you can see right there, there's no bushings inside that eye of the shock. They were completely gone. And that's all that was left of the bushings in the other side of the shock. They're just dry, crunchy polyurethane. And this is what the bushings look like new here. For my original design, I used a 5/8 inch steel rod here for this top bar. And I found that was just a little undersized, because what happened was that bar bent upward in the middle. I used to have the side shocks about 2 inches lower to keep the shocks from hitting the fender here. They actually do hit now a little bit. But before, I had the shocks kind of limit, you know, right about there, and then this force of the center shock pushing up bent that bar. So what I did was I went to a 3/4 inch bod here, and I think this is actually a high carbon steel drill rod, so it's real high strength steel, and that's worked perfect. But one of the problems is the bushing has a 5/8 inch inner diameter. So originally I took a die grinder and spent about 10 minutes grinding out the insides of these bushings here. So you can see that one, the bushing is a lot bigger inside. I do have some extra bushings, but what I thought I would try instead is I took these bushings and I measured the dimensions here. I got but with a variable size hole here, so I have parameters in my drawing file, so I can make this 5/8 inch or 3/4 inch hole or any size you want, and it'll generate the model file. And so then I exported that for 3D printing, and I'll show you a video clip of the printing process. It takes about 2 hours to print one of these. So I was thinking, instead of modifying another one of these by hand, I would try to 3D print some bushings and just see if they last. So I'm using TPU thermoplastic polyurethane filament to print these, so they're still polyurethane, but I figured, let's see how well a 3D printed shock bushing lasts. I mean, these lasted a little over 20 years. Let me go get those bushings and we'll see if we can get them in here. I got to get this rod out. Okay, yeah, managed to get everything apart. The problem I ran into was that I have spacers between the two sets of shocks, and the rod had, I guess, rusted inside of the spacers. I had greased them up the last time I had them apart, but that was probably like 18 years ago, I think. So I guess over that time, the spacers got frozen to the rod and I couldn't get the rod out. So I had to break out the impact, and I got this guy, big pipe wrench on the spacer, and then I got an impact gun on the nut on the end of the rod and spun it around enough times that I could finally get it out. But anyway, I chewed up the spacers, so I got them painted right now. I'm letting the paint dry. But just to show you the purpose of this shock setup here, if you look here, here's where the shock goes when it's fully extended. In fact, yeah, there, it's still coming out. So you can see this is a gas pressure shock. I think this is the 99012 model, if I remember right. If I had it mounted to the axle like I do, it would want to go clear through the top of the fender here. So I have to like squeeze it way down. That shock would be way too long to fit in there because it can't go up high enough to fully extend, and then it's going to be too strong when it compresses. That's the reason I have these here. These limit how far up it goes, but then it can still go down farther. But yeah, anyway, just show you the bushings I came up with. So here's the original L1 shock bushing. And if there's interest, I'll put the STL files for these up on Thingiverse on my page there. And I think I need both here. The bottom bolts are 5/8 inch. But like I said, I had to change the top one to 3/4 inch. So yeah, there's my top rod. And then I had to do a slight modification to it. I think this is what I built for the original version because it was a lot tighter together. But then when I redesigned the shock tower, I moved the outer shocks out a little bit. So I needed to lengthen the rod about 1.5 inches like that. So I have a tube right there, and then I have it threaded on the end, and that bolt screws in. So I need to do that because this is so long. You have to feed it in this way, and then push the shocks back in place and then slide it forward. There's no way you can get this out in one piece. And then just show you here, you've got the adjuster on the shocks. I just leave these on full stiff. These side shocks really only come into play when you either top out or bottom out the main shock. So these most of the time just sit there. Since this shock here is gas pressure, it's pushing up all the time. So it takes these side shocks and fully extends them. Get the bushing in there. I've got the one in this side. Had these soaking in some hot water for a while, but they've kind of cooled off here. I just want to see if I can get this in place without taking the U-bolts out. Trying to figure out how to get around the camera here. Yeah, the other one was easy because I could lay it down. It's a little bit harder when they're free hanging here. There we go. Yep, pops right in there. You just got to get the right angle on it. So yeah, there we go. Got two new shock bushings. And the main idea of 3D printing these, one is I can print them already pre-modified for the larger rod. And then I also want to test out how well this TPU filament lasts in like a shock absorber bushing. Like, does it fall apart in 6 months or does it last for years? This stuff lasted a little over 20 years, but if this lasts, you know, 5 or 10 years, the neat thing is I can just print another one of these and put them in there, and I don't have to modify them every so often. I can just use them as is. This is more of a test, just sort of a proof of concept, see if a 3D printed shock bushing will work. And I guess the only way to find out is do it, run it for a number of years, and if it holds up, great. If it falls apart, then I'll know the answer. So yeah, I'll show you what it looks like when I get it all back together here.